In the previous video, I looked at a distribution-free test for the difference in proportions. It was based upon the product binomial. Now, when you think product binomial, you're thinking of an actual specified distribution. But what makes this a distribution-free test is that it doesn't matter what the distribution is of the underlying data that is behind our observations that we're collecting. The fact that we're using the binomial distribution is separate from what's the distribution of the data that we're observing. Though a hypothesis test for the difference in proportions, namely to see if there is a difference in proportions, is valuable, I want to look at a confidence interval for the difference in proportions. That's what we will do in this video. So the goal is we wish to construct a confidence interval for the difference in proportions. In the last video, I called that delta, and delta hat was the estimate of that difference, but delta was the population difference in proportions. I'm going to do the same thing here. We have a random selection of study participants. We must have independence of our two conditions from one another, as well as independence of the observations within conditions. Here's the population parameter, delta, that we're going to focus on. Delta is equal to pi 1 minus pi 2, where the pi's represent the proportions in the populations. We can get either a two-sided confidence interval, in which we have both a lower bound and an upper bound, a lower bounded confidence interval for delta, or an upper bounded confidence interval for delta. I'm going to use two R packages, the desk tools package and the exact CI diff package. If you want to follow along, you must have these packages installed, but you don't need to load them if you use the same commands that I will show in this video. The product binomial is known as Barnard's test, and so desk tools does an exact implementation of Barnard's test, distribution free, and the exact CI diff package inverts that in order to give us a confidence interval. Let's use the band tryout data from the previous video and the accompanying product binomial article. In that example, we selected a sample of size 20 and randomized them to two conditions. 10 students we assigned to the morning tryouts for all-state band, and 10 students we assigned to the afternoon tryouts for all-state bands, with the idea of trying to determine if in the population there is a bias toward either the morning or the afternoon in terms of success in getting into the all-state band. Here are the outcomes, and we can see in the sample data that we have 80% success for the morning group and 40% for the afternoon group. That would suggest that the morning group, in fact, does have preferential treatment. However, this is just one sample, and as you know, there's going to be sampling variability when it comes to looking at the difference in proportions if we take other samples. So that's why we have to do a hypothesis test to see if we can verify that this difference would actually exist in the population as well. So I can do the hypothesis test using Barnard's test. I'm doing it here using the desk tools package and the Barnard test function. One key thing to note is that we have to indicate where our sample values are fixed. So if we look back at this table, notice that I have fixed the values in the rows. That is, our sample sizes are represented in each row. We have 10 in the morning, 10 in the afternoon, rather than in columns. It doesn't matter whether you put them in rows or columns, as long as you set this argument fixed correctly. In our case, we want fixed equals 1 to mean that the sample sizes are in rows. If we changed it to fixed equals 2, we would have the sample sizes in our columns. We ended up here with a p-value of 0.1158. If that sounds familiar to you, you watched the previous video in which we did this all by hand, and we came up with a p-value of 0.1158. So here we're just using a function to do the exact same thing that we did by hand. Now let's construct a confidence interval. I'm going to use the binom CI function that is in the exact CI diff package. I'm going to try to build both a two-sided interval and a one-sided interval. Then normally we only do one of these. We do the one that matches the research question. So let's suppose we are looking for bias in either direction, either bias of the judges in afternoon sessions or in morning sessions. It appears that there may be some bias in the morning due to our sample results, but what can we say about the population? When I run the function and do the two-sided interval, I end up with an interval that ranges from minus 0.01 or about minus 0.02 up to 0.72. And in this particular example, I know that I have subtracted afternoon from morning. We have to tend to that because subtracting afternoon from morning would give us a positive result. And notice that most of this interval is in the positive range above zero. That said, the interval itself ranges from really no difference at all between the two times of day, all the way up to a 72 percentage point increase in the success rate if we look at the morning as compared to the afternoon. Notice my language here. I didn't say a 72% increase. I said a 72 percentage point increase. A 72% increase would imply that we take whatever the value used to be, find out what 72% of that is, and then tack it on. But what I want to do is simply take the afternoon success rate and add on 0.72 or 72 percentage points for the morning success rate. Suppose now that the research question had been whether judges are biased toward the morning. Perhaps we have a hypothesis based upon personal experience, past observations, or past studies that seems to indicate that judges may be biased in morning sessions. Maybe they're more fresh, or maybe the performers themselves are fresher in the morning. In any case, this would lead us to use a one-sided confidence interval with a lower bound because of the way we subtracted again, afternoon from morning. And this result would give us from 0.11 to 1, meaning that we have at least an 11 percentage point increase in the success rate in the morning than we do in the afternoon. And note that this is a 90% confidence interval of the value of delta in the population. This isn't about delta hat. We know what delta hat is. That was 0.4, the difference between the morning proportion and the afternoon proportion of success. But what we want to know from that is what can we infer to the population? And with 90% confidence, we can infer that the proportion of success in the morning is 0.11 or more greater than the proportion of success in the afternoon. What about if we have large samples? Let me illustrate the large sample method, but I'm going to start to keep this same example going by illustrating the large sample method with a small sample. That is, I'm going to use the same data that we've been looking at both in the last video and in this one so far. The large sample method is based upon the central limit theorem, which tells us that the distribution of proportion estimates are going to be normally distributed. And so this is based on the normal distribution. I'm going to use the prop.test function, which is actually a part of BASR, and the default is to include a correction for continuity. That's a good thing, so I'm not going to change that. Remember, correction for continuity is a way to achieve better results with discrete data when we're using continuous distributions. And the data here are discrete. Not every proportion is possible. We only have a sample of size 20 divided into two samples of size 10 each. So only certain proportional differences are available to us. The correction for continuity will try to help us adjust for that when we compare to a normal distribution. So running this test, again, I'm setting the confidence level of 0.90. You see, I end up with a larger p-value than I did with the exact test. Which one do I prefer? Obviously, I prefer the one with the distribution-free test. And then I have a 90% confidence interval that is actually wider than the one I obtained when I did the two-sided test based upon Barnard's test, the two-sided confidence interval based on Barnard's test. So prop.test, when we get big samples, can be a way to use the normal distribution. In this case, I have a small sample. I would use the distribution-free Barnard's test instead of the large sample method. Now let's move to another example. This time it's going to be an example in which we have a large-scale study. Physicians from around the United States participated in this study. These are real data. They were randomized to two conditions, daily aspirin or daily placebo, and the physicians did not know which group they were in. After many years, data were recorded about the presence or absence of a myocardial infarction, that is a heart attack. And so here you can see the numbers. Note that our sample sizes, again, are in rows, and we have placebo with 10,845 without a heart attack and 189 had a heart attack, and then we have aspirin. So let's build the confidence interval for that. The confidence interval for prop test, notice that I'm putting in the number of heart attacks here in my first vector, and then in the second vector, I need the two sample sizes, and so I'm creating a vector in which I add up the first row and another vector in which I'm adding up the second row. So we have here the number of quote-unquote successes. I wouldn't call a heart attack a success, but using the generic term success, we have 189 of those out of a sample of 189 plus 10,845, and similarly 104 over 104 plus 10,933. We run the two-sample large sample test. Our confidence interval tells us that we can infer that the increase in heart attacks is about a half a percentage point, 0.005. It seems like the difference could be quite small, but remember two things. One is that we're talking about the lower bound being at least a half a percentage point. The upper bound could be much higher than that. And we're also talking about a heart attack. So we have to think about context when we're considering whether effect sizes are big or small.